Good morning to all of you who are watching this program in MS Teams, Facebook and YouTube. And it's indeed a great day for all of us to hear from one of the pioneering scientists, engineers and policy makers of the country, Padma Vibhushan, Dr. Ranganath Anand Mashelkar ji. He is an inspiration to a whole generation or several generations of scientists in the country, and he will be talking about building Atmanirbhar Bharat with Atmavishwas. Atmavishwas and self-reliance are very, very important, and Professor Mashelkar in a number of cases have led the country from the forefront to retain the traditional knowledge that it has by combining with the most modern science. And he is probably one of the most respected scientists across the world. And it is our fortune that he was able to lead the country on a number of occasions and continue to guide many people and inspire many of us to take the path of science and innovation and how to develop trust in the scientific community at a time where the world is under crisis. Scientists are looked upon by the society to provide solutions. While there are so many problems that people are facing due to COVID, it is also an occasion to reflect upon us and see how we can strengthen us in multidimensional ways to combat this particular crisis. And we are extremely fortunate to have somebody of this stature like Dr. Mashelkar to agree to give us this talk within a short time, because the summer research training program that CSIR has started is not a planned one. It is because some situations have pushed us to take it up, and there is a lot of enthusiasm, and I am very, very happy that the CSIR family has come together to rise to the occasion and provide summer research training program to close to 16,000 people within a short notice and planning of a couple of weeks. So I request Professor Alok Dhawan, Director IITR, to introduce Dr. Mashelkar. I know that Dr. Mashelkar do not need any introduction, but for the sake of a large number of a few thousands of people who are there, who will be listening to Professor Mashelkar, I request Professor Alok to give an introduction to Dr. Mashelkar.
Thank you so much, Shastri. I think it's a wonderful day today, bright and sunny. Perhaps out of the gloom, we have such a wonderful personality amongst us. He is not only a personality; I would say we have an institution amongst us. In Dr. Mashelkar, he is not only the national chair professor, but he also has served as the president of INSA and the president of Global Research Alliance. He is also the chairman, he served as chairman of the National Innovation Foundation. And he has several firsts to his credit. He has been the longest serving DG of CSIR from 1995 to 2006. He has been honored by 42 universities all over the world with their honorary doctorates, including University of London, Salford, Pretoria, Wisconsin, Swinburne, Monash, and it can go on. Dr. Mashelkar is also the first Indian to win the most prestigious TWAS Lenovo Prize, which is considered to be, and that was in 2018, considered to be a mini Nobel Prize for developing world scientists. He was the first Indian from India to be elected as a fellow of the US National Academy of Inventors in 2017. First Asian scientist to win the Business Week USA Award of Stars of Asia at the hands of George Bush Sr., the former president of the US, and the first and only scientist to win the JRD Tata Corporate Leadership Award in 1998 so far. He's also the only third Indian engineer to have been elected as the Fellow of the Royal Society since 1660, seventh Indian scientist to have been elected as Foreign Fellow of the US National Academy of Sciences since 1863, and the seventh Indian to have been elected as the Foreign Associate of the American Academy of Arts and Science since 1780. He is not only an exceptionally brilliant academic, but he is also steered in a sense several companies through his presence in the board of directors. And to name a few, who he has been on the board of directors of India's most reputed companies, which include Reliance Industries and Tata Motors, as well as Hindustan Unilever. I think from a personal perspective, I would like to say that Dr. Mashelkar not only led the CSIR during his period as DG to a lot of Atmavishwas in the young scientists, but he also made or ensured that CSIR becomes Atmanirbhar. And during his period, we started looking at how we do zero budgeting, and from there move on to ensure that we have everything under control. He has not only served in various high power committees, 12 of them to be honest, as Mashelkar committees for the Government of India, but also has been a member of the Scientific Advisory Council of the Prime Minister, and his mantras from less for more and the Gandhian engineering have been a constant source of inspiration to the corporate and as well as youth alike. He founded the Anjani Mashelkar Foundation to promote innovation or a commercialized product or service. The innovation must address the problems faced by the disadvantaged resource poor people in India. And as I always mentioned during the COVID times, he was the and is still the PPE of CSIR, which means that he has practiced, he has preached what he practiced, and he empowered to the hilt. So I think that was exceptional era that we had. He reinvented CSIR from a pre-patent era to a post-patent era, which now ensures that CSIR ranks among the top most government organization in terms of patents. We are number one. He also started the PPP model, which was the public private partnership model in CSIR. And then he gave the four P's, patent, product, publish, and prosper model to CSIR. And for which I think the Government of India has bestowed on him the three P's, the Padam Shri in 91, the Padam Bhushan in 2000, and Padam Vibhushan in 2014. He has not only written profusely in different forms, but his books, especially Reinventing India and Leapfrogging to Pole Vaulting, has created a transformation in the way not only academics think, but also how the companies are looking at the metrics of innovation. He has now put forth the assured metrics, which is affordable, scalable, sustainable, universal, rapid, excellent, and distinctive. I think that makes him very distinctive. The fact that he is amongst us to share his views, I mean, I can go on for the time that is allocated to him to introduce him, but I think the person that we have amongst us today is a joy to listen to him. It's always a pleasure and privilege to sort of imbibe what he says, to absorb some of his words that he so very profoundly expresses. And he has his viewpoints on how the country should excel and how we means the people who are the budding scientists of this country or the next leaders of this country should conduct themselves to in order to actually create an Atmanirbhar Bharat. So with these few words, it is my profound privilege and pleasure to request Professor R.A. Mashelkar to deliver this talk on this occasion. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Alok. Can you hear me properly?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So first of all, thank you, Alok, for those wonderful words. And you talk about these three P's. I would say there is another one that you can add. This is the purpose, perseverance, and passion. You have to have a purpose in life. You have to persevere to achieve it, and you have to do it with sort of a passion. I am particularly grateful to Dr. Narahari Shastri for giving me this opportunity, for thinking of me. And in fact, you have done me a great favor, because any time I interact with young people, I add years to my life. I'm already 77. So it is not just adding years to my life, but life to my years when I interact with young people. So thank you for giving me this opportunity. Let me come to the topic that I have chosen, but let us remind ourselves that we have gone through a big upheaval in our life, unprecedented. The coronavirus pandemic crisis, where lives have been lost, livelihoods have been lost, economies have been destroyed. And it's a question of now just rebuilding, recovering. But this is also our chance to reinventing and reimagining ourselves, basically. And therefore, when our Honorable Prime Minister gave us this Atmanirbhar Abhiyan as a not merely a slogan, but as a call, a clarion call for a movement, I think it has set all of us basically thinking. So to start with, in the Atmanirbhar Bharat, we have to realize that yes, it is self-reliant India, but it is not one which will be just closing its door, not in isolation, but it will be integrating. So it is the integration with global supply chains, basically, that is very important. We are not going to isolate ourselves. And his appeal, the Prime Minister's appeal, is that we stand up in sort of confidence. You know, no country can take us for a ride. And we have to restore that old pride, old glory. I think that is the call that he has made. Now, I have added a word, that Atmanirbhar Bharat with Atmavishwas. Why I'm saying Atmavishwas? Atmavishwas is confidence, self-belief. So my talk is going to be focused on how do we create Atmanirbhar Bharat with Atmavishwas. You know, people call me a dangerous optimist, by the way. And I am a dangerous optimist. And why am I dangerously optimistic? It's all because of my listeners today, the young people, the Yuva Shakti. You know, I remember Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji, our former Prime Minister, used to say, India's future is as in IT. And by that he meant information technology. I also used to say India's future is in IT, but IT as in Indian talent, because there is nothing to beat Indian talent. Okay. And I remember about 10-15 years ago, when I used to start, I used to remind everybody that 0.06% of Indian population is generating 1/3 of our export. And you know what is the average age of that 0.06%? 26.5, generating 1/3 of exports. It was all our youth power that actually basically did it. So my confidence comes from this talent, which is backed up by technology. And what I'm going to say is that it has to be backed up by trust. Trust coming from confidence and coming from self-confidence. The first point, therefore, when we talk about Atmanirbharta, self-reliance, let us look at, for example, manufacturing. Now, we launched Make in India, for example, and that was a great initiative. But Make in India can't be just assembled in India. It has to be invented in India, okay? And then completing the chain from invention to innovation in India. Let me tell you why this is important. For example, you know, you all have mobiles, okay? And Foxconn used to make mobiles in China. And for every mobile made, iPhone, Foxconn will take $10, China would take $10. But for that, Apple would take $250. $10 versus $250. Of course, that $10 had a caveat because you will create 4.5 million jobs. Okay, because jobs are required. Whereas Apple high tech, you don't have those many jobs. So what are the three options before India? The first is to do this, sweat it out, and get $10 but 4.5 million. The second is think, create, innovate, and you get $250. The third is, it is not either or, it is both. You have to create jobs on one side, but also create wealth through our innovation and creativity. So take that $10, get those jobs, but at the same time, take that $250. So that's what I mean by not just assembled in India, but invented. Now, if we keep on doing assembled in India, we are going to have challenge. And let me give you an example. If you look at mobiles, I'm just continuing with the examples of mobile because that is current. You will find our Indian companies, Micromax, Carbon, Lava, etc. 2014, if you just see, they had 45% share of the market. You know what is it today? 9%. 45% they came down to 9%. So who ate the lunch? The Chinese ate the lunch. Because they came out with Xiaomi and Vivo and Oppo, etc. And their share 5 years ago was 7.5%, today it is 68%. So we went down from 45% to 9%, and they went up from 7.5% to 68%. Why? Because we just remained, we are trading, we are just assembling, basically, not doing any innovation. Whereas they were doing innovation. So I think the first point is that there is no substitute to inventing, innovating, and that is where research becomes important. And as I always said, research converts money into knowledge, and innovation converts knowledge into money. So research and innovation have to go together. Okay? That's the first point. The second point is that when we say Atmanirbhar Bharat, is it the option of just buy or make? Because that's what we talk about. Either we'll buy technology, buy products, or we'll make technology ourselves or make products. No. The Atmanirbhar Bharat cannot rest on these two pillars. It has to have five pillars. And let me explain those five pillars, okay, in order to remain strong. The first is buy option. The second is make option, but the other three, where you have a big role to play through research and innovation, one is buy to make better, one is make to buy better, and third is make it together. So the five pillars, I repeat, are buy to make better, make to buy better, and make it together. And all great nations have followed these five pillars. So let me explain. First of all, buy. You can buy when you have dollars. You can buy technology when somebody is willing to give you. But there are many times when technology will not be given to us, basically. You know, and they not just in strategic areas. I remember in good old days when I was on the IPCL board, we wanted alpha olefin technology. Why? Because alpha olefin sulfonates were good detergents, better than LABs. We went to Idemitsu, we went to Chevron. They would not give it to us because they would look at us as a not bottomless pit of demand, but competitors. So buying is not always easy. The second point is make. And make is, of course, the preferred option. Now, while we use this option of buy or make, we have seen the dramatic change. For example, before the coronavirus pandemic hit, we were importing 70% of the PPEs that Alok referred to, not in the way that he referred to, but these are personal protection equipment, 70%. Today, within 3 months, actually, we have created a $1.5 billion business and we are exporting. So India is completely capable of doing it. But do we have to do it only when we are pushed, like we were pushed? We have to be proactive and do it on our own. There is nothing that is impossible, you know. Then the other thing is actually buy to make better. Buy to make better means what? For example, let's look at our pharma industry. In generic drugs, for example, we are number one in the world. But as far as the active pharmaceutical ingredients are concerned, APIs are concerned, 68% of them we import. So what happens if that import gets stopped? Our drugs and pharma industry is in trouble. So I'm very happy to see that now the government has taken this great initiative to manufacture API in India. Even they have identified 50 plus, and CSR, our CSR is playing a sort of a big role on that. So buying to make better, yes, we're buying those APIs, making drugs and pharma, and then we were exporting to the rest of the world, and we became a sort of the world. In the same way, for example, I was listening to Rajiv Bajaj on the other day, and he said we import 600 crore worth sort of components from China, but I export 15,000 crore worth scooters. Okay, so there is a component, China component, in everything that we do somehow or the other. And I think we have to relook at what we are importing and say, hey, do we have to, like in PPE case, we quickly said, no, we'll do it ourselves, and we were able to do it. So I think this idea of make in India, invent in India is going to be very important. Now, make in India would mean, again, our big companies prepared to move to India and sort of manufacture in India. You know, 2019, September, the Nomura report actually had a survey of 56 companies that were moving out of China, moving out, basically, and they were looking for alternative destination. You know how many of them opted for India? Just 3. But that is a pre-COVID situation. Now, post-COVID, people have lost trust in China, and they are looking at alternative. And what better destination there can be than India, all right? But we have to set our house in order. Land, labor, legislation, logistics, the cost of inputs like electricity, etc., we have to fix. And I'm happy to see that the government is at it very much, so that that so-called ease of doing business really becomes ease of doing business. What I see and predict is that India's fortunes are going to change in a big way, and we have a big opportunity. In fact, people are looking for forming partnerships with the politically trusted countries, like the D10 that you must have heard. You know, 5G, you must be seeing. There's a lot of discussion at the moment on leaving out UAE and then creating alternatives. Now, Britain has proposed the D10, where India is a part of it, and countries are assembling, basically. So we used to talk about techno-nationalism, you know. Then it became techno-globalism, okay, where there were global supply chains and so on and so forth, in both trade and technology. Now it is going to be selective techno-globalism. That means some countries will come together, like, say, Israel, like Japan, you know, like US, like India, etc., etc. So this is the new world where we have to actually sort of get into. I wanted to give you an overall perspective to start with before I come to research and innovation, because you have to have the big picture before we come to sort of detailed role of research, technology, and innovation. Now, if you look at our technological sort of capacity, that's where I talk about talent, technology, and trust. Okay, We have all the talent in the world. We have access to now technologies. I think what we must have is a trust. We have to believe in ourselves and have a trust. Since we are talking about testing, and Dr. Narendra Shastri talked about the wonderful work that your lab is doing, CSR is doing on testing, etc. We require diagnostic kits for that. So let me give you an example. Alok mentioned about this Anjani Marshallkar Inclusive Innovation Award, which I give in my mother's name. One of the award winners was Nitin Kabra. Nitin Khanna from IGIB. And what did he do? He had a dengue kit. Because normally, I hope none of you have got dengue, but if you get that, you would have found that it takes 1 or 2 days before you detect. Now, he created a kit, you know, which actually could detect in 15 minutes. 15 minutes. And also at what stage it is. So it should be a winner. But nobody would take it. We would be buying it from South Korea, from Australia, from United States of America. Nobody wanted to give him a chance. And then one day what happened was that we had a pandemic. And in that pandemic, all the kits were exhausted. And therefore we had to order. Now US said it will take a couple of months, our processes. Australia said same thing. South Korea said we'll give it. And then South Korea actually, sent it by ship. And the ship, rather than coming to India, went to Africa by mistake. So India was left with no kits. So what do you do? Then they went to Navin Khanna. And Navin Khanna started from there. And then from 0% market share, he has 78% market share today. Now, if you can imagine, supposing that ship had come to India, Navin Khanna's kits will still not be in the market. That's what I mean by talent, technology, and trust. We had the technology, which was better than the best of the world, and yet we did not have a trust in it. So the analogy that I have is like R.K. Lakshman's cartoon, where, you know, there is an eye patient, and he's looking into his eyes and testing, and he said, oh, there is a particle. Shall I take it out? And I'm asking you because it's a foreign particle. You get the point. So I think the point is that we should not be sort of lured by these foreign components. We have to have our own. We have the capacity to do that. And I'm giving the example of kit because that is current. That's what we are basically looking at. And you have seen, the way we have sort of moved into this space. So that's what I mean by trust. Now, many times we are ahead of the rest of the world, and still it is not taken up. I'll give you an idea of something that happened in 2001. You know, there was a technology that was created. It was called Simputer, and it had technologies which were ahead of the world. Like, for example, features in iPhone that came later, or Samsung Galaxy came later, you know, they were actually involved there. And in fact, Bruce Sterling in New York Times, you know, he wrote, and I will read out to you. He said, most significant innovations in computer technology of 2001 were not Apple's gleaming PowerBook G4 or Microsoft Windows XP, but it's a Simputer, a Netlink radically simple portable computer intended to bring complete revolution to the third world. What happened? Did we bring that revolution? No. Because although Simputer had features which were incredible, like for example, it had anticipated those breakthrough technologies which are commonplace in mobiles today, like an accelerometer introduced years later in iPhone, or dongle on mail, ability to write on phone. You know, these were the major features of Samsung Galaxy, which came much later. So we're ahead of the rest of the world. And still we did not make it. That is where I mean talent, technology and trust. So how does it work then? So when you have breakthroughs like that, what is normally done is that government becomes the first buyer. So let us say there was an order that was placed for, let us say, 10,000 of computers. Then they were used in practice. You would have got the market feedback, improved the product, and today we could have been a world-beating product. Now, how important such innovations are, because computer was supposed to be permit truly simple and natural user interface based on sight, touch, etc. And it was able to read and speak in 7 Indian languages. It was just made for India and very, very affordable. That's exactly what we need in 2001, I'm telling you. Now, how critical this is today, I'll tell you. For example, the number of changes that have happened after COVID, as you must have seen, home has become not only home as a working place, because we are working from home, but also school. As I speak, 160 crore children today in the world are learning from home, isn't it? And all of you are having these iPads and mobiles, etc., etc. But what about the poor? What about those in villages who have no connectivity, who cannot afford iPad, who cannot afford a smartphone? What about them? So you will find that we had in Simputer the possibility of having something which is very low cost, available for maybe $20, $30, all right? Not $300. And I remember when we had, and Alok will remember it, we had this New Millennium Indian Technology Leadership Initiative. And if you remember, I gave a grand challenge in year 2000. I said, laptop is available for $2,000. Can you do it in $200? And it was done by Vinay Deshpande. Okay. He did it in $200. Unfortunately, that letter support did not come through a public procurement policy. And therefore, what happened? Well, you don't hear about it today. But if it was $200 then, today it would be $30-$40. Or we had this Akash, for example, which was $35. I'm talking about 10 years ago. It could have been nothing. And this could have been in the hand of the team. So what we require is not just technology, but a policy backup. And therefore, the public procurement system has to be geared to that. And if you go on the web and look at ram@mashelkar.com, that is my email ID, but www.mashelkar.com, I repeat, www.mashelkar.com, you will find my public procurement policy report, because Amitabh Kant, the CEO of Niti Aayog, did a wonderful job of putting together 17, let us say, different initiatives, which he said will change the world, change India. And one of them is a chapter that written by me on how to deal with these sort of public procurement issues of the startups, basically, and to give them a sort of a fair deal so that they have, they can run sort of faster. So what is the simple point I'm trying to make? The future lies in your hand. You are completely capable of creating technologies which are ahead of the rest of the world, not copying. I always said, I in India must stand for innovation, not inhibition, not imitation. All right? You don't have to imitate. You don't have to copy. You will create something ahead of the rest of the world. But if it is backed up by sort of public policy, and I'm very happy that the government is trying to do a lot in that, then we can win the world. We don't have to be sort of afraid at all. I'm also finding that after COVID, the way scientific community has risen is absolutely fantastic. Whether it was Department of Science and Technology, whether it was Department of Biotechnology, whether it was our own CSIR, whether it was private sector, it is phenomenal. Now just see what we were when 30 January, the first case appeared in India. We had limited diagnostic capability. We had no point of care diagnosis. We had no vaccines. We had no therapeutics. The biology was completely unknown, you know, of this highly infectious virus. And from there, I mean, if you just see, I'll take just only example of CSI. I'm not biased, although, as a, you know, I'm part of CSI family, but I'm just taking that example because I'm more familiar with it. And you can see how quickly Dr. Shekhar Mande, our wonderful Director General, followed by great team, some of you are there, created these five verticals, you know, digital plus molecular surveillance, rapid economic diagnosis, new drugs, repurposing of drugs, hospital assistive devices, supply chain management, etc. And many of what we have been able to do, many of the things are ahead of the rest of the world. Like the CRISPR-Cas9-based technology that Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology has done. It has higher specificity than anything else, and cost is just 500 rupees, not 5,000 rupees, you know, paper strip. And the partnership with Tata Sons, actually it is sort of moving it forward. So it is entirely possible to basically do that. Let me for a minute come back to my make, buy to make better, but there is also make to buy better. What does make to buy better mean, the fourth option? That means in a technology, you take certain steps by which you get not only familiar, but you master that technology. For example, what happens once you do that? You find that the rest of the world actually follows you. You know, look at, for example, I remember I was a member of Science Advisory Committee to the Prime Minister in Rajiv Gandhi's time. And I remember there was a discussion. He asked us, what are you good at? And I remember Professor Narasimha saying, we are good at this. So what do we do with it? And that is where the, Cray had denied us the supercomputer at that time. Okay. So he said, we'll make our own supercomputer. And that will be parallel processing based architecture. And in 1991, we created the first supercomputer, 1991, Param 8000. Result of that, because we made it ourselves, was that although it was denied to us, because we were they were afraid that we'll use it in design of nuclear weapons, US government said supercomputers are not necessary to design nuclear weapons, the Las Alamos report. So as soon as we had developed that particular capacity, the strategy changed. Then 1991-92, we even exported this to Canada, Russia, etc. In 1998, we created the Param 10,000, which was 100 gigaflops. And then what happened? We had developed our own capacity, and Cray came and said, we will now supply you the supercomputers. So what do I mean by make to buy better? You had to demonstrate your own capacity that you can make it. All right. And then we could buy better, because otherwise they would not have given us the technology. So that is the other option that we have. The last point is, of course, making it together. Remember, buy, make, make to buy better, buy to make better, and make it together. Now make it together. I mean, again, once again, in the NIMITLI program, New Millennium program, I remember Biosuit was created. TCS came in, Tata Consultancy Services, and 19 laboratories. Tata Consultancy Services knew how to make a product because bioinformatics, we needed. The software Accelerus was available for $500,000. A small biotech companies could not work. But this public-private partnership created it just by $5 million within 18 months, which was ahead of the world. So we made it together. Neither TCS, Tata Consultancy Services, would have been able to do on their own because they did not have competence in life science, nor our laboratories would have been able to do on their own because they had knowledge, but they did not know how to make a product. But together, as a public-private partnership, we could actually do it. So this is precisely what we need to do. And Atmanirbhar Bharat, therefore, I repeat on these five strong pillars. I'd like to end my talk in the next 15 minutes or so by actually giving you what I call as 10 Mashelkar mantras, if you like. Okay? And each one I'll illustrate, because when we talk about Atmanirbharta with Atma Vishwas, all these attributes become very, very important for us. So I'd like to end by talking about these 10 mantras. The first mantra is, aspirations are your possibilities. Keep them high. Because if you aim at Everest, at least you will go to Kanchenjunga. But if you aim at Kanchenjunga, you may not be able to go to Hanuman Tekadi. And if you aim at Hanuman Tekadi, you will be standing at ground only. So you have to aim high. I remember when I took over as the director of National Chemical Laboratory, 1989. This was in the pre-liberalization days. What were we doing? We were copying. We were reverse engineering. And that, of course, helped us. Because, for example, 70% of the agrochemicals that were used for Green Revolution were done by us. But they were all copied molecules. And it was perfectly admissible. Same thing in generic industry. Generic industry means the molecule is known. You are just creating an alternative process for that. But we did that. But then supposing you did something which was ahead of the rest of the world. I found that when I went to Indian industry, they would say, no. Have they done it? Has Japan done it? Has US done it? Has Europe done it? So that Atma Vishwas that I talk about, Atma Nirbharta with Atma Vishwas, was not there. The confidence was not there. So I said, what am I selling? Knowledge. And what is my market? The whole world. So I said, National Chemical Laboratory will be International Chemical Laboratory. We'll export our knowledge to the rest of the world. And can you just imagine, which was very audacious. When I say export my knowledge, that means I'm licensing out my patents to the best companies in the United States of America. How is it possible? In fact, I remember after I gave my speech on the opening day, a young man came to me and said, sir, do you realize, I mean, I had talked about even licensing patents to General Electric, because I'm a polymer guy, so I was doing something in polymers and they were leading in what is called as polycarbonate. He said, how can you dream of licensing it to them? They are the 40% market share. I said, no, it is not the power of budget. It's the power of ideas that matters. And we did that. Within 2 years after that meeting, we had licensed out 3 of our patents for close to $1 million to the leader, actually, to the leader in that particular field. All right. That is what I mean by aspiration. Keeping it high. We said international capital. The second is perseverance pace. I told you when I began with passion, perseverance, and the purpose once you know. So remember, it is too early to give up. Winners never quit and quitters never win. You know, Michael Jordan, the legendary basketball player, had once said, I have missed 9,000 shots in my life. You know, but I never gave up. So I think that is very important because we tend to be impatient. That's second. The third is, be always a part of a solution, not part of a problem. And because I'm talking to the young, I'll give you examples of young. You know, there is what is called as a National Innovation Foundation, of which I was chairman for 18 years. It looks at grassroots innovation. What does it mean? That means it is not innovation done in CSR laboratories or universities. It is done by ordinary people in the field, by children, by housewives, and so on. And we honor them. So I'll tell you about one Shalini, 13-year-old girl. She was in Bihar, 12-year-old girl. And she saw her grandfather walking with great difficulty, climbing up the stairs with great difficulty. He had a walker. And she said, no, I must make it easy for him. And she designed another walker with front loaded, you know, springs, legs, by which he could sort of walk comfortably. And we helped her from NIF to create a prototype. And that was licensed later on. And can you just imagine 10,000 of these getting manufactured every year? She's getting a royalty which is more than her father's income. A 12-year-old girl, Shalini, because she did not want to be a part of a problem, but part of a solution. There's another girl from Kerala, Remya. You know, her father was down with cancer. Her mother was perennially ill. She had to actually change 3 buses to go to school. And after she came home, she had a problem because she had to wash the clothes. That was her duty. And also to study. So either she could wash the clothes or study. She said, I will do both. And she created a washing machine, which was pedal driven. I mean, you know, by her legs, she could move the pedal, the rotating drum. And so she could actually both wash as well as study, read. She did not become a part of a problem. She said, I will solve it. So I think that attitude is most important. So that is my third lesson. The fourth is, don't knock on doors of opportunity all the time, because many of them will not open. When they don't open, create your own doors. I remember when I joined NCL 1976, India was a poor country at that time. And I remember as a research scientist, you know how important equipment is, and many of them are imported equipment. So I was a student of geology and non-Newtonian fluid mechanics. And I needed what is called as a Weisenberg reorganometer, an equipment. And it would take 18 months to get it. Oh, okay. Because we did not have foreign exchange. And there was digitally clearance, not manufactured in India certificate. You have none of that, by the way, at the moment. If you want a $5 million equipment, DG will give it to you. Your director will give it to you. That was not the case at that time. You know, we had to wait. So what do I do then? Do I fold my hands like this and say, I will wait for 18 months? No. I changed my feet. I said, what do I have? I have this. And I went into modeling and simulation. Okay. And the work that I did on modeling on simulation, basically, I started work in 77. In 82, in 5 years' time, I got Bhatnagar Prize for that work, which, as you know, for under 45, that's the highest sort of prize. Now, you can just imagine if I kept on knocking on the door so that I get that equipment, that door would not open for 18 months. I said, thank you very much. I create my own door. And we had modeling and simulation. And actually, the kind of modeling and simulation we did, K.R. Nath, the student, you know, later on he got employed in AspenTech, headed their polymer division, and he was telling me when he visited South Korea, they were using our modeling and simulation. So that is the power of Indian mind. But the message to you is that when the doors don't open, create your own doors. That's the fourth lesson. The fifth lesson is that, particularly for the young, I want to insist, you know, remember, like instant coffee, there is no instant success. You have to work hard. I'm 77 now, but I can assure you, I work 24/7, day after day, month after month, week after week, year after year, and I will do so till I breathe my last. But remember, work hard in silence. Let success make all the noise. We start making noise even before we are successful. So that is my fifth Mashelkar mantra. The sixth Mashelkar mantra is the following. There are three attributes all of you must develop. First is innovation up here. Second is passion in the belly. Third is compassion in the heart. All right? Sympathy is one thing, empathy is another thing, but compassion is most important. And what does it mean, compassion for the poor? I mean, today we have seen the challenge with the migrant labor and so on, so forth, etc. You know, people have lost jobs, they have hardships, etc. We should be continuously thinking about them, basically. I have sleepless nights when I think about them. So therefore, the award that I created, Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award, was one where we would say how can you have technologies, high technology work for the poor? Because making high technology work for the rich is very easy. Making low technology work for the poor is very easy. But making high technology work for the poor is very difficult. So we said we'll give that award. And this is the 10th year of the award, by the way. And you know the kind of awards that were given last year, whom did we give it? We gave it to those people, as you know, the manual scavengers. Their life is so difficult. Their life, they live for just 30 odd years, basically. They can't enter that manhole, so they drink, their livers get destroyed. Their children in the school, they have no dignity, etc., etc. So last year, we gave it to this young startup called Bandicoot. They have created robots which can actually go inside the manhole and do the cleaning. Then we say, what about their jobs? No, what they have done is that they have trained them now to operate the robots. So rather than a manual scavenger, he becomes a robot operator and his dignity comes back. This is what I mean by innovation, compassion, and passion. We look at, for example, the poor. I mean, if there's an old lady in a village who has suddenly, let us say, pain in the heart, and she has to be taken on ECG, we'll put her in a bullock cart and take her to the doctor a couple of kilometers. You don't have to do that. Rahul Rastogi was an award winner, for example. He created something which looks like this, basically. He's an electronics wizard. And what you do is you put your two thumbs like this, basically, for 15 seconds. And this particular part with a sensor, this is your heart. 15 seconds. Okay. And if you have downloaded an app called Sanket, then in your mobile, you'll get it. And 100% accurate ECG, by the way. Cost, not 200 rupees, 500 rupees, just 5 rupees. Now you can just imagine that same old lady. If you had the connectivity, what would happen? You can do it sort of from where you are. Now that is what I mean by innovation, compassion, passion. Mihir Shah, for example, a young fellow, his mother-in-law had died because of cancer, breast cancer. Why? Because it was not detected early. Why? Because she was afraid of mammography, because it is painful. So he said, I will do something which is non-invasive. And what he did was to create what is called as eye brace, which again, you put around your breast. And within 5 minutes, you know whether there is a breast cancer. Cost of that? $1. $1. Not painful, not at all. And this is now going to 25 different countries. I'm giving you these examples because here there was not just innovation, not just passion, but compassion in the heart. All right. So we have to worry about this poor nation and create technology. So that is your sixth Mashalkar mantra. The seventh is, remember that you can do anything, but not everything. So you have to focus on what you want to sort of do in life. The eighth mantra is that being positive is extremely important. When you see a half glass that is full, half glass that is empty, we start writing editorials on the empty. No, look at the full part of it. And that attitude, I'll tell you, will go a long way in your life. I'll just give an example. I remember Delhi University, there was a physics teachers association. And you know, there was some turmoil and they were going to take a morcha to the vice chancellor's office after the inaugural. And I remember the person who will tell us what to do. So I had some 10 seconds to think. I said, well, I've never addressed 300 people who are in coma. But maybe he did not mean coma. He meant we are at a comma. And what is comma? You're written half the sentence, you're taking a pause, looking back, and the rest of the sentence could be positive. The entire para can be positive. The entire page can be positive. The entire chapter can be positive. So I said, look at it like that. Okay. And can you imagine? After that, the tone of the discussion changed after I left. Because anytime anybody said negative, they said, no, no, what did Mashalkar say? not coma, comma, and they dropped going to you know, the vice chancellor's office with a morcha. So just that positive thinking, you know. So when you see a darkness, don't start cursing it. Bring a candle, bring a light, you know. That's what I sort of made. So that is my eighth lesson. There are two more lessons. The other lesson I want to sort of mention, particularly at the end, is that, you know, you will all get your PhDs and so on and so forth, and then you will feel that's the end. And I remember Banaras Hindu University, I gave the 100th convocation. And at that time I said that, I don't know whether Alok, you were there, but it was called Dikshant ka matlab Shikshant nahi hota. That means when you get this degree, that's not the end, that's just the beginning. That is because the world is changing so fast. You require new skills, new technologies. What the way the knowledge is quadrupling is amazing. In fact, I heard one US Secretary of State say that almost two-thirds of the children in senior school will end up in jobs that don't exist today. Okay? So how do you then teach about jobs which don't exist today? So there are certain sort of qualities that you have to aspire. One is dealing with complexity, like, you know, you have, this is a hookah word, as they say, volatile, uncertain, complex, ambiguous. For example, this pandemic, I mean, it has brought in all the sort of complexity. The other one is emotional intelligence. And I told you about the importance of this. The third one is cognitive flexibility. The fourth one is the ability to co-create. And the final one is creativity. Because if you have these attributes, then they will last you forever. And the last point, and I will end my talk by telling you about last point. So if you go to my website, you will see there my tagline, there's no limit to human imagination. There's no limit to human achievement. There is no limit to human endurance, excepting the limit that you put on yourself. Accepting the limit that you put on yourself. And there are examples like Arunima Sinha, you know. She was a national level volleyball player, and she was pushed out of a train, and her one leg was amputated below the knee. And can you imagine, after she was pushed out, within 2 years, she climbed Everest. That is the human achievement. That is the human endurance. So that is the spirit that we have to always sort of remember. And I said there is no limit, you know, to human intelligence, human imagination, human excellence. So let me give a personal example and conclude my talk. Professor Sena Rao, as you know, is all our idol. He's an icon. He's our guru. He's Bharat Ratna, greatest scientist that India has today. And excepting for Nobel Prize, he has won everything, basically. And I hope that will come sooner rather than later. He has been my guru, and he has always put a lot of demand on me. So I remember I became fellow of Royal Society, as was mentioned earlier. Now, what is FRS? Fellow of Royal Society, many people consider it as kind of next to Nobel Prize, you know. And in fact, I remember when I became FRS, I got a mail from a fellow FRS saying that enjoy it, because only two greater things can happen in your life now. One is Nobel Prize, and secondly, death. One is certain, another one is uncertain. So that is how it is regarded. And you sign in the same book on which Newton has signed on page 9, etc. Great honor. So I called Professor Rao and said, sir, I have become FRS. I thought he will say, great, congratulations. He didn't say anything. He said, not bad. So I was very disappointed. Then I became US National Academy of Science, like Alok mentioned a little earlier, only the seventh fellow. Again, I phoned him up. He said, again, not bad. Then that US National Academy of Inventors, at least I was not seventh or third, etc. I was the first one to become. So I phoned him up and again he said, not bad. Then I lost my patience. I said, sir, what do I have to do to impress you? And the lesson that he gave me at that time, I want to leave it with you. In your research, in your career, in your future. He told me, and although my formal name is Raghunath Mashelkar, people who know me closely call me Ramesh. So he said, Ramesh, you are climbing on a ladder of excellence, which is limitless. There are no limits, okay? Only the limits that you put on yourself. So what he was telling me was that your best is yet to come. Okay? So my last message to you all, the 10th Mashelkar message is the following. Every morning when you get up, what you should say is my best is yet to come. And maybe today is the day when it will come. And you should do it not when you are 20s like you are now. In your 30s, in your 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, all of you will live for 100 years, by the way. The longevity is going to be so much. So even when you are 93, that morning when you get up, you say, my best is yet to come. And if all of us do it, and that's the power of the Yuva Shakti, that is what I began with, where will India be? India will be right up there in the committee of nations. So that would be the dream for my Atmanirbhar Bharat. That will be my dream for Atmanirbhar Bharat, with that Atma Vishwas that every day will ensure that we do better than the best than we did the earlier day. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Excellent. Excellent talk. Very inspiring indeed, sir.
It's very difficult to let everybody clap, because our system will have so much noise. Thank you for firing us up to go from leapfrogging to pole vaulting and climbing the limitless ladder of excellence. And this is a truly inspirational thing for all of us and young people. And your message that you will work 24/7, day after day, week after week, and this is probably not only optimism, but patriotism at the highest level. And with this type of leaders that we have, and all of us are really blessed to have you, sir. And Atmavishwas has gone up manifold, and there are a number of questions that are there. More than 1,000 people have attended, and I will try to take. Sir, is it possible for you to answer a few questions?
Oh yeah, sure. I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah. So I will try to say that there are many questions which really praise you and compliment you. And there are some young people who also have some questions. Like, for example, Anjali has a question that many people have a notion that foreign products or international products are good and promising. This will affect the idea of Atmanirbhar badly. How can we change their notions? And in the same way, Dr. Rohini Mandhare asked, in some sense, why Indian youth is not confident for starting entrepreneurship? So you may answer.
Yeah. All right, I'll answer both. Both are excellent questions. Let me, I always talk about things from the book of my life, not by reading something and then telling you. So whatever I experienced. So let me answer this question by an experience that I had. So one day I was addressing the young, and I do it selfishly because when I talk to the young, as I said, I put life to my ears. So I wanted to excite them, and I said, look, who is the CEO of Microsoft? Yeah, Nadella, our Indian, we studied in India, our own product. Who is the CEO of? I said, Sundar Pichai, an Indian, studied in India. Okay, so all of you should dream about becoming Satya Nadella, Sundar Pichai, and so on and so forth. I thought I was exciting them. So one young fellow got up, and nowadays, by the way, young people are very direct. You know, they ask you really make tough statements on your faith. So one fellow said, "Sir, I don't think you understand us." So I said, "What happened? I thought I said something nice about India, Indian education." They said, "No, sir. Your generation was just interested in going to US some or the other. Came the next generation, they wanted to not only go to US but get jobs in top companies like Microsoft, Google. The next generation, they said we should not only go to US, join Microsoft or Google, but become the CEO of Microsoft." He said, "Not our generation. We want to create our own Microsoft, our own Google here." So my experience, by the way, about youth is exactly contrary to what you say. They are not only confident, you know, but they are daring to go. I think the examples that I gave you, all these, whether it was Shalini, whether it was Raymond, whether it was Rahul Rastogi, it was Mihir Shah, whether it is these young people who made Bandicoot, you know, they're all in their late 20s, basically. And look at what they've done. They have done something which is ahead of the rest of the world. So that is Atmavishwas. That is that Atmanirbhartha. That is where the Ten Mashalkar Mantras, they become important. Like, for example, confidence comes from hard work. Confidence comes from perseverance. As I said, winners are never quitters and quitters are never winners. You know, you have to have that stamina. And then you will basically achieve. So I have no doubt about what is going to happen. And the other point about the product is, because people always look at high performance envelope, basically. You know, and that's why I always talk about affordable excellence. Affordable excellence. And India is specialized in that, because normally you say affordable excellence is contradiction. What is high quality can't be done affordably, what is affordable can't be done high quality. No, but India specializes in that. We create what I in fact about 10x, 10 times better and 10 times. We are making these products actually, and the sort of ahead of the sort of rest of the world. I think quality matters. The customer today basically wants high quality. And as long as you give him high quality, India must make those products. India should not only manufacture for Indian audience, customers, but for exporting. And you can't do export unless they are high quality sort of products. So Indian industry must go for high quality. And once that happens, there is no question. The government doesn't have to force you to buy it. You will buy it on your own. Okay.
Thank you very much, sir. There is another question. There are several questions in this direction. And one question which is a little different is, sir, we all know learning through experiment is more beneficial than theoretically. Still, our education is mostly based on theories which lack our ability at industry level. What's your opinion regarding this? So this is a perception of a young guy.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. That's a great question, because I always said education is future, and it is time that we moved from not just right to education, but right education. Okay? And not just right education, but right way of education. As you can see now, the hybrid learning is coming, digital plus physical, not the right way of learning, isn't it? Now, in terms of right education, there are three or four points I'd like to make. The first point is that we all, I mean, at least my generation, did learning by rote. That means you memorize everything and reproduce it, you know? And the questions will be also like that. Like, for example, on my life, there is a lesson in sort of the 10th standard textbook in Maharashtra. And then what happens is that they say Mashelkar was born in a poor family in a poor village called Mashel. And the question will be, where was Mashelkar born? You get the point. So that is no question. But what that textbook has now done is that the kind of questions themselves are different. For example, I got the book Reinventing India. So they have given the titles of that the chapters and said, five of you get together and discuss as to if this is the title, then what would be the meaning inside. So what is happening is that it's not learning by rote, but learning by doing. Not just learning by doing, but learning by creating. And not just learning by creating, but learning by co-creating. That means you all work together. Okay? So the most important part is learning by doing. Remember, when you talk about education, there are three components to it. First, learning. And that you can learn digitally. That's not a problem. The second is doing. Doing by hand. And there is no substitute to it. And the final is being. Being a part of the society. All right? That's why digital learning cannot just take away the normal education. It has to be digital plus physical. Because that social interaction is extremely important. Now, in the doing part of it, doing by hands, you know, is very critical. And that's why I remember when we had this Prime Minister's National Innovation Council, I was a member of that. And we created that program called Tod for Jod program. We wanted Tod for Jod Center, you know. And what were those? That means you allow your children to sort of break things, make things, create things, etc. Of course, now we have the Atal Innovation initiative, etc. Where exactly the same thing is being done. I think that has to be allowed. You must learn to fail. For example, the meaning of fail should be different. It is first attempt in learning, by the way. Fail is first attempt in learning. So unless, and we penalize children who fail while doing things, basically. So we have to develop that sort of tolerance. And remember, the great breakthroughs will come not just by learning the facts, but creating new artifacts. You know, we always complain, oh, Nobel Prizes don't come to us because we are poor. Come on, what are we talking about? It came because somebody did something. What did he do? There's a piece of graphite that was taken. There's a scotch tape. You put it on that, put another scotch tape, folded it, unfolded it, folded it, unfolded it so many times till there was a monoatomic, and that is graphene. That was the breakthrough that Russian young person had. Okay? And that was by doing an experiment. It could not have been a thought experiment. And that won the Nobel Prize. So when people say, I don't believe in that, as a matter of fact. So that has to be given the emphasis. And learning by seeing is very important. You know, when I went to school, by the way, I remember I went to, being a sort of a poor child, I got a admission to a poor school, but I had a rich teacher, like Professor Bhave. And I remember he would not do just chalk and talk. You know, how many of you have seen a soap factory? We saw a soap factory. I was so poor that in the tram, my ticket that was required, also, but he bought my ticket. And we saw Hindustan Liver factory making soaps for, you know, and that gave us sort of ideas. So the entire process of learning has to be learning by doing, learning by creating, and most importantly, learning by co-creating. In your life, you will never do anything on your own. It has to be a team which has to basically work.
Thank you very much. Actually, there is another question that many people were asking, that politics and education are very important for the progress of the country, but there is less education in politics and there are more politics in education, which are detrimental. How can we understand this?
Well, I knew always there will be a googly or a bouncer. So I got that. I'm not a politician. I don't understand politics, very frankly. All that I would say is that we have to have democracy.
Can I answer that question, sir?
Yes, yes, please.
I think, my dear friends, you have to follow Dr. Mashalkar mantras, Ram mantras, I would say, the 10 of them.
And if you actually follow them, you neither have to bother about politics, nor to bother about anything. And with your optimism, you can be contributing to Atmanirbharta with lots of Atmavishwas. Atmavishwas and optimism is important. Life is there to enjoy, not to analyze. Please try to push all your energies in a positive way. And our country is a great country. Have confidence in you, have confidence in the country, and then let's not worry about these things. If you approve that answer, I will go to another.
I have to approve, and thank you for coming to my help, because there are questions I can't answer. This is one of them. But I would say that we require a democracy, but we require an enlightened democracy. An enlightened democracy will come through education, and that is extremely important. And education with values. You know, our major challenge is that, like we say, education, the purpose of education, if you just see, it is jnana savardhan, buddhi savardhan, vyakti savardhan. Okay? But most important part of it is mulya savardhan, the values, basically. And one that is embedded, basically, you know, your genetic changes. I think we require that. The values are sort of most important. Everything else is temporary. Values are sort of permanent. I think that enlightened democracy with values is, even at this age, 77, I'm looking at. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And we have a little question by a person who is insisting that please respond to this question. And his question is, there are many people in India who are intelligent and want to start their own business, which can lead to many opportunities to the learners. But the problem is that people are lacking financial support. So what could be the solution? Many people thinking that they have to get financial support from somewhere.
That's a very good question. Anything which is analogous to that, or can I answer?
Something, all are very similar to this. So they have some good ideas. They want to start the industries. And how do you get the financials?
I think you have raised a very important point. And for that, I would suggest that if you go to my website, you will find that I have recently written an op-ed in Indian Express. And actually, it is about startup and there, particularly in terms of new space, in a sense, space technology, you know, microsatellites and other things, etc. There are new opportunities. And in order to do that, there are 5-point agenda that I have put there. And one of them is exactly what you are talking about. When you have a new idea, see what happens in India is that when you have really a breakthrough idea, new idea, you are doing something for the first time. That is where finance is lacking. Same ideas, people will be happy to support you. So I don't call it venture capital, I call it adventure capital. What we require is adventure capital, where new ideas are promoted. Like when we created New Millennium Technology Leadership Initiative, anybody with an idea, for example, you know, whose chance will be 1 in 100, we gave money for that. We had created so many other programs where the best ideas we gave money, you know. So government has to come in, you know, because if you go to a normal bank, commercial bank, if you go to a normal venture company, that will not happen. And government can come in a sort of a big way in this. Look at, for example, what we have done at Maharashtra State Innovation Society. I told you about startups and the difficulties that they have. Because you can start up something, but you don't have money to market it. And then the question that will be asked by any lender would be, what is your 5-year experience? What is your 10-year experience? It is almost like asking a 15-year-old Tendulkar, when he was hitting a century in the Bombay Ranji Trophy match, that you will not be admitted in test because you don't have 10-year experience. Something like that, you know, despite proven performance. So what we have done is that we have created a completely different system of tendering, where the experience doesn't count. Your excellence counts, your power of your ideas count. I'll just give you an example. A fellow had developed some drones which can float on the surface of, let's say, water and do the cleaning. Now, in Pune, for example, we have this Pune Chinchwad, Pimpri Chinchwad Municipal Corporation, and we made sure that without tendering, that fellow, young fellow of 27 year old, got a contract to actually use it. And once he used it there and successful, he got dozens of other orders. But had we gone through the normal process, you would not have got that chance. Okay? Now, if we have done it in Maharashtra State Innovation Society, it can be done across India, as a matter of fact. And we require instruments of that kind where government plays an important role. Also, when you don't have money, I'll give you an example. Rahul Rastogi. I told you about this kind of device where he is able to get a correct ECG. In fact, when we gave him the award, it was only 6 lead. For a real ECG, you require 12 lead. Okay? So I said, no, you have to make 12 lead. So he said, sir, whatever I had in my pocket, I put in, I don't have money. The same question that you are asking. So what I did was, Tata Trust had invited me to talk about some future and so on and so forth. So I took that device. I demonstrated it to them. And I had asked him, Sanket 1.0 you have done, which is 6 lead, to do Sanket 2.0, what will it take? So he said, it will take 46 lakh. And he showed to me the bill of materials and everything. First, I had to convince myself before I back up anybody. So I went there, actually showed it to them. And can you imagine, Tata Trust wrote out a check for 46 lakhs within 48 hours. Within 48 hours. And therefore, he went from 6 lakh to 12 lakh. So today, if you go on Amazon and put Sanket there, you can buy it, by the way, for 2,500 rupees. And it is being sold everywhere. It is being used sort of everywhere. But if that money from Tata Trust had not come, it would not happen. So what I'm saying is that is corporate social responsibility, for example, that is available. There are 26,000 crore last year that was available. What would it take to support people? You? How many hundred crores, as a matter of fact? So therefore, we require people with the sort of right heart. And I just give you 2 examples. If I had 1 hour, I would give you 10 more examples on how that can be basically generated. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, there are so many questions. We take 1 or 2 more questions before I can ask Dr. Mutkavi to say a vote of thanks. One more question. Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
This is an emotional question. That if someone says that you are a failure, you cannot do it because somebody failed, and they talk very badly that you can't do that and you will not be fit for anything. And how do you tackle such a situation?
Yeah, I think that's an extremely important question. I think basically it's the self-confidence that yes, I can, that is the only solution for this. Okay, if somebody is saying it can't be done, it is his problem, not your problem. Okay, and you have to have that confidence. That's why I said Atma Vishwas. Failure is all sort of relative. Failure might mean you are not able to deliver on time, you are not able to deliver quality, etc., etc. And hard work is a substitute for proving that person wrong. And there are any sort of number of instances, including, by the way, I have a list of Nobel laureates whose papers were rejected by scientific journals. So for them, it was a failure at that time, but they went on. The quality of what they did was such that they went on to win Nobel Prize. Okay, so I think basically what you have to say is that if you say that I'm incapable of doing anything, what you have done is that you have looked at it from a lens. You have to better change your lens. And I can be. I mean, for example, I would be a failure if I was trying to play cricket and like Sachin Tendulkar. But Sachin would perhaps, I don't know, but he might be a failure if he was trying to be a scientist. So there are three things that are important in life. Please understand that. One is ability, second is attitude, and third is aptitude. Okay? And all three are important. Okay? If you are missing one of those, then there is a failure. Okay? And therefore, you will always have an aptitude for something, you know, in which you will be good. I remember my friend Naresh Shah and my classmates, and because we were so close, you know, he joined me in the college. He was lousy in science first year, dropped out. His parents were saying, you're a failure, etc. He changed his field. He went to architecture, and he's one of the greatest architect today. He went to sort of Washington. So there will be always something good in you. I remember on my 60th birthday, when I was felicitated, and that is also available, by the way, on my website. They asked me, what is leadership about? And what do you specialize in? I said, I believe that there is a God in everybody. And my job is to find that God. I remember when I was doing guiding students, I'll just give you a specific example. I had a student called Balasubramanyam. I had a student called Ravindranath. I gave Balasubramanyam some theoretical work, modeling. And I gave Ravindranath experimental work. Balasubramanyam was complete failure. He couldn't write a simple equation. Ravindranath, he couldn't hold a test tube. So I switched, basically. Ravindranath went on to become what you saw, because he did theory and modeling and simulation, becoming the head in Aspen of Polymer. And Balasubramanyam went on to become the sort of R&D chief of a petroleum oil company, because he was absolutely superb in experimentation. So ability, attitude, and aptitude. Okay, all three are basically important. You may be a failure in one, but you can be a grand success, grandmaster in another.
Thank you very much, sir. This was fantastic. Actually, we have Dr. Ajay Ghosh, Dr. Kalesh Alvi, in addition to Dr. Alok Dhawan and our Dr. Mutkavi, who will be giving the vote of thanks. And before we go, we would like to have this our students have made this two PPT slides during your lecture.
Oh, this is fantastic. The
five pillars of Atmanirbhar Bharat.
Wow.
Buy to make better, make to buy better, and make it together.
Wow.
And also they have also captured the 10 Ram mantras that you have given, sir. And this is the next slide. So the mantras are aim high, perseverance, and then we will probably give it to you. And then we will probably use them as Ram mantras for our Atmanirbhar Bharat with Atmabishwas. Now
I make a request to you. If you can, one of your colleagues can mail it to me.
I'll mail it.
I will tweet it.
Yes.
I will tweet
yes,
it.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Tweet it immediately.
And also this one, we have made it to the best of our abilities within the time. So it will be really good. So we will take it as really the sacred Ram mantras from the Guru, you sir, and thank you very much. I request Dr. Mutkavi to conclude the session, and maybe Dr. Mutkavi can also give the opportunity if others in the session would like to say something. Maybe Alok can also say something. Right. Dr. Mutkavi, now the floor is yours.
Well, I don't want to take too much time, because I think, you know, what I would like, of course, my pleasure to propose a vote of thanks. Before I was, you know, I was making some notes out of Professor Mashalkar's lecture. Before the lecture started, I wrote down sincere thanks to Dr. Mashalkar for his, as usual, inspirational talk, because I had the Atmavishwas that this talk is going to be as inspirational as any other talk I've heard from him. I had no doubt about that. Okay, absolutely no doubt. And, you know, absolutely astounding talk. And even that, not just, I think, you know, youngsters, but I think in all the whole spectrum of ages, you know, like the, so that's what I would like to thank you so much for this, taking your time off and addressing all the youngsters and also the CSI community, which is also joining for the lecture. Like Narayan Shastri said, maybe I would like to hear from my other colleagues some comments, maybe Dr. Alok, and then maybe other directors who are here, and then I will conclude my, you know, like the part of the vote of thanks.
Thanks, Dr. Muthukuri. I think we can't comment after a lecture by Dr. Mashelkar. I think we're just mesmerized beyond any thought process. So I think if we just imbibe what he said, and I think we are very grateful to him to sort of agree to it and share his wisdom, as he always says, his own experiential learning that he's had over the last 77 years. Maybe I can leave out the 2 years when he was too young to imbibe things, but last 75 years for sure. And thank you very much, Dr. Mashelkar, for sparing your time in the morning and sort of enlightening us, enlightening the democracy of this country, I would say. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Ajay Ghosh is there? Yeah, okay.
There till now, but currently. Kalesh Selvi is there? Dr. Selvi? Okay, sir, there probably.
So, okay, so maybe my time now, okay, to conclude this session. Once again, thank you very much, sir, for taking your time off and addressing the students and the directors of. I think we're all students when you're talking, there's no doubt about that part, right? So I'll just, you know, involve myself as another student who's listening to you, regardless of my age difference with other people who are here. And like you said, you know, the excellence is a never-ending ladder. And therefore, you know, there's nothing like, you know, I'm so much here, so many years old, which in itself is very inspirational because, you know, we're facing a pandemic. We don't know how long we're going to live. So let's not worry about that. I think we'll think that we'll live as long as we can and, you know, climb the ladder of excellence. I think that's the message you have given us essentially. And you spoke a lot about the, and you spoke about the trust, a lot about that trust. And I do believe that you have put a lot of trust in the youngsters of India. And I'm very, very sure, you know, like your vision of India, which is, you know, scientifically enabled and a enlightened democracy will emerge because you have placed that trust in the youngsters who are listening to you today. And I'm quite sure that will multiply because I think the positivity multiplies just, you know, maybe even faster than the negativity. So that's an important message you have given us, placing the trust. Whether somebody places trust in us or not, we must actually trust others. And the other interesting thing I learned from you today was, you know, IT, which I always used to think is in information technology, is an Indian talent. So that's probably we must always remember. And you have given us, well, others are calling the Ram mantras. I will call it 10 mm mantra, because 10 Mashelkar mantras. Okay. So as an engineer, I'll think of it as a 10 mm. So as usual, your talk was full of, you know, real life examples, which I think that's what actually has made a lot of difference. I've heard you so many times, and every time there's something new to learn. My request to youngsters who are still tuned in, and I hope they're all tuned in, is to go back and re-look at the YouTube lecture, which is recorded today, and go back and re-look at it again and again. Yeah. Because I think, you know, the many examples will have a different meaning at different phases of our lives. And there will be different learning from the same examples at a different times in our lives. And that's what I sincerely request youngsters to download it, keep it, and listen to it. Whenever you feel, you know, not very happy or whatever, I think you listen to these lectures, I think, you know, there will be a way forward, you will see. And it will also help India grow into a more inclusive country in the global scenario. Like, I think there's another message, because Atma Vishwas or Atmanirbhar Bharat does not mean that we shut the doors. It's extremely important that we become integrated into that global arena, but also we are be seen as real competitors, I think, and then the real value addition in the global competition. Not just, you know, going to US and, you know, becoming somebody who is from India, but, you know, being in India and then, you know, being a global player. Thank you very much. And thanks to Dr. Alan Dhawan for introducing the chief guest. It must have been a very difficult task for him to do so. So I'm quite sure, but it's a wonderful introduction you gave. And thank you so much for that one. And thanks to Dr. Naren Shastri for, you know, starting all this. And thanks to his big team, very young team, and then, you know, they've been working very, very hard. I know how difficult it is to make sure that, you know, everything works well and works as per plan. Thanks to all the team that is behind Dr. Shastri. Thank you very much. And this session concludes. I think any questions you can probably summarize and provide it to Dr. Mashelkar. For maybe whenever he has time, probably can give us his inputs on that for our own education. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I think we will be collecting all the lectures, all the questions that are there, and then try to answer. And if we also will give it to Dr. Mashelkar. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Bottom of our.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
My special thanks to the team.
Yes, sir.
The team, Lakshmi and all other colleagues who made this possible, because you know the kind of difficulties we had yesterday, but we did not give up. We'll make it happen, and absolutely perfect today. So that's what happened. Perseverance pays. It is always too early to give up. All right, we did not, and see the product today. Fantastic. So my personal thanks and congratulations to your entire team, Narari.
All backing up, not maintaining social distance, but hope that they are doing a great job.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.